okay, I'll give you a first impression of things which we like to discuss. You see here what is evolution, so that is the basic thought. How far are we humans progressed in our human development? What about our pasts? Very interesting. And then we talk about the awakening of our minds and also the several phases that we already passed after the awakening of our minds till present. And we call it the Lemurian Atlantic phases. Of course, there is a lot still to develop, and we talk about the spiritual development and a choice. And special item, I think this is, you may say, the first half, and the second half we will discuss the question, is the ideal society, is the future, is that high tech? And is it what some people say, as, do the computers will have a great impact and a great role in that? Yes, yes or no? So that's a very point which is discussed now. Also, when we have time, we will also discuss with each other the design baby. Yeah, the whole point of the enormous possibilities to change the DNA of cells. If we have time and if you like. How to lead these developments and we come to some conclusions. So, when we start, what is evolution? Perhaps you have been here too, yet it is always very worthwhile to lay down the foundations of the thoughts, because theosophy is a logic system, and when you know that the basic thoughts, you can understand why we say what we say. And one of those basic forms is all forms are ensouled, according to the old wisdom. Behind every body, behind every star, behind every planet, every human body or an animal or a plant or also a mineral, there is an entity working. So we say consciousness is always the driving force behind everything what you see around you, the whole nature. Without exception, so we look to nature, to the cosmos as one living whole, one living community. It is an, you can say, a really different view of the cosmos than you normally hear in our society, but we think it will explain a lot. So, that is a first interesting thing. Also, coupled to this idea that we are ensouled, that we are consciousness, and our consciousness has never been created, it has always been, you have always been, you were always part of the cosmos, and coupled to that thought is the idea of reincarnation. Yeah, we think this very logic, because how do we grow, how do we develop ourselves is always periodically that we are active periods, and then we need some spiritual rest and we retire our consciousness into spiritual realms. So it's always the need to have periods of active learning, active experience, and then afterwards we have to digest it by sleep and also by what we call death. So that's the way all beings do it, not only human beings. So planets, suns, have their period of evolutionary experience, and then they must retire too, after many, many millions of years, of course. So that's also a key thought. When we die, we take with us our spiritual lessons. And those are the things with which we will be born in our next life. So we build up, we develop our consciousness. Another point is we look around us, and when you see how all things are dependent on each other, when you think about that no human being can live without whole humanity and without the planet, then you already all know that we are dependent on each other. But theosophy goes one step further. We say it is not only a question of dependence or a question of narrow ties. No, it is a fundamental unity. So we are factually united, not as an ideal, not as a question of we should try to reach that. No, it is a fact. We are united because all human beings are the expressions, or you can say the emanations or the children of one boundless, indescribable life, which is the fountain source of every human being, every being whatsoever. Well, there are boundless number of beings, so this source is also boundless. And well, all religions and philosophies tried to point to that boundless source and called it the One, the unnameable God, or Allah with its 100 faces, or the boundless, but the name does not matter. The idea, that's the point, there is a factual unit and every being is a little piece of the great mosaic of life. Eh? If you look to the whole cosmos as one colorful mosaic. Perhaps you are not always conscious that it is so, but it is a fact. Yeah. Depends if you are seeing it. And the last thing is all beings have the drive to unfold their limitless potencies. This has to do with something which is so normal that we do not think about it so lot, and that is the fact that all beings are continuously changing. We are never the same after one day or after 1 hour. We are continuously learning, continuously a little bit or more, but we are never the same after a short period or a long period. So consciousness is eternal and also ever-changing. Why? What is the drive and what is the cause of that ever-changing beings? And then we say the deepest cause is that in our spiritual self we have the urge, the drive from our own inner urge to unfold more and more of our potencies. Because we always, in our actual lives, can only materialize, and only express parts of all our possibilities, never everything. There is always something to win and to broaden our ideas and to broaden our abilities. So this is the third idea. And it's three very great ideas, we think. And we will make the next step now. We can show that idea, that urge of trying to develop more and more what is in us already, to unfold the possibilities and potencies that are already in our consciousness with this scheme. It is only a scheme, but it gives the central idea. You see here the path of spiritual development, and you can look here at the left side, you see seven aspects of consciousness, seven powers of abilities of consciousness. And it is in fact from the more material powers till the most divine powers and all things between. You see that consciousness has many sides, and all sides belong, in fact, to our path of evolution. The bodily form, senses and feelings, the powers of that, vitality, life energy, our ability to realize our goals and aims, we call that desires, that is not negative, it is neutral, because you can use desires also for very great and noble purposes, yeah? And also for very low purposes. Desires is the power. Thinking, very important for us human beings, but there is more than intellect, spiritual insight and living from unity. More and more spiritual things. And when you look to the enormous, you can call the great cosmic path of evolution, of development, in our cosmos, in our present great cosmic school, then we see that we are belonging to this school, the school of human kingdom, learning to think, but we have already passed schools and that took many millions of years. And we call the first school the elemental kingdom, beings which that just start in our cosmos, and those beings are still busy to learn, to build up an own characteristic body. So they learn that during their elemental phase, and they are helped by the mineral kingdom, which already is able to do it. The mineral entities are in fact learning gradually to react on their surroundings more and more actively. They learn to create senses and some kind of feelings, and they are helped by the plants, which already are able to do it. Yeah? The plants are trying to, to control their vitality and use it, and they are in fact stimulated by the animals. The animals are busy trying to, in fact, to develop their desires. You all know, animals have desires. Take, for instance, the example of an hen, a chicken. And a female chicken always tries to find a very quiet place to lay her eggs. And you see also, for instance, in the bio industry, that where there is not a possibility to have a quiet place to lay eggs, they feel that as a big problem. Yeah, their normal desire cannot be realized, and there is suffering. Yeah, there's animals have desires with all the kind of sufferings when it cannot be realized. We are trying to investigate, to learn to think, which is an almost spiritual faculty, thinking. Yeah, it has an enormous lot of possibilities. And we are helped by the DB gods, we can call it. Entities one step further than we. And they are busy with cosmic spiritual insights and are helped by the gods, which are purely living from unity and with all the consequences of that from a divine standpoint. So it is a great things before us, but we already have made an enormous lot of preparations to be in this phase where we now are. Yeah? And we can understand all those beings because we have passed it too. We are, in principle, able to understand what an animal is trying to do in a plant and in a mineral. Perhaps a first question? Yeah. And here you see the human school, but it is really a scheme. It's really schematically, in a schematic imagine, our spiritual history and future in one big half circle. But it is a symbol, of course, and we will give you an idea of what it does mean. And You see here three points, a star, a point, and a point. And what is the... Here started our human school, our human development. And where are we now? I will say already at the averagely, the average human being is at a yellow point of the enormous journey of human development. Now you see that the first half is symbolically a line going down. And what do we mean by that? It is in fact the first half of our cycle, and it is generally focused on ever increasing materialization. So in this period we went through many phases, but all those phases had as goal that step by step we could manifest our all our seven human possibilities in a bodily form. And that took a long time before we were, you can say, complete manifested human beings, sevenfold from our spiritual till our most physical body. It all had to be built up, developed, before we could start to think. And it is at this point. It is the point where I always heard that you can do it also this way. Here is the point where our mind could be awakened, because we were in fact complete as manifested proto-human beings. Yeah. So it was a very long time, because the whole school has the same cycle, the same number of years, as one life of our planet, as one embodiment of our planet. So from the birth of our Earth until the death of our Earth, we are able to develop our human potencies. Which is an interesting thought, because we were there at the birth of our planet. We were builders. We have helped to build up the first phases of the planet, just like all the other beings of our planet. It is cooperation which is the keynotes of the whole nature. So we have helped there, building it up, and that is about 2 million years ago. And now we are averagely here, and we still have about 2 million years to go before we can reach, if we choose to do it, the Buddha or Christ or our human potencies fully developed. And that must be here. The line upwards is a symbol for the opposite. Here we are busy with materializing, and here we are busy with spiritualization, with developing our higher potencies, our higher thinking faculties. And that means that we will more and more live in our higher natures, in our higher thoughts, in our higher ideals. We will recognize that as our real source, our real core, our eternal core. So we will, in fact, really become it. Yeah? We will really realize it more and more and become it more and more. And during the same time, our material instruments will become more and more the servants of us. We will still need them. The Buddha still needs all his instruments, yeah, from the highest to the physical body, but they become more and more controlled, we can use them for the most noble goals. That is a question of developing more insight and learning to control, to be really masters of our lives. Now, we all know that that is an enormous goal to reach. Yeah, if you look around, it has enormous thing to do yet. And okay, we can summarize. This is a kind of involution of the spirit. We started as unconscious, very ethereal entities. We were not physical, but very ethereal, yeah, spiritual cores, but knowing nothing about human life. And that spiritual core of us clothed itself in more and more and more material sheets or clothes till this moment. And then the opposite thing, then we develop our spiritual possibilities, but we envelop, we take it with us, the more material elements of our nature. So it forms a kind of mathematical formula, enveloping spiritual, developing spiritual, or here developing material and enveloping material. Yeah, it is a mirror, those two. Well, now we come, if you like, to the point of the awakening of our minds. We are talking about our spiritual history, and according to theosophy, that phase of our history is one of our most important milestones. So it is really worthwhile to think about what happened there. Before that, we were in the human school, but could not think yet. We were proto-humans, busy to be prepared to really start thinking. Just like a baby now. Yeah, when we were a baby in a baby phase, we could not think yet, but very quickly we were able to think in this incarnation, because in all former incarnations, it was our normal way of doing. But this is the big issue. All spiritual teachers have told us about that awakening of our minds in parables and myths. There are many myths about it. Prometheus and also the Bible and the Garden of Eden. Myths about the awakening of our minds. And you find it in all religions. So it has happened about 18 million years ago. So between this point and this point are about 18 million years of development. And can we compare this process to something we already know? Because then we can understand what it is. And we say, oh yes, sure. You can compare this with the toddler phase, the little child phase of our present incarnation. Think about what happens when a baby grows into a little child of 2 or 3 years. That little child proves that he has his own thoughts because he's going to ask questions. He is saying I to himself. I want this, I think that. Yeah, that means self-consciousness, that means thinking. And you will see also that at that moment, the little child has an independent sense of good and evil. He knows that from inside. There is good and there is evil. I can do things which are not good and which are good. And it is a crucial phase in our own incarnation, but it was very crucial during our big development as humans. Why are we each incarnation repeating this awakening of our minds? Well, the point is that according to the teaching of the cycles of theosophy, at the start of each cycle, we must go through all our former phases that we already have passed in a very rapid way. We must recapitulate them. Perhaps very shortly, but you cannot make a jump. Nowhere in nature an entity can make a jump. So you cannot become born like an adult. you should have those reawakening of all the things that you already managed, but which were lying latent for during the death. So that means this will be experienced by us each incarnation as a little child, and it goes very quickly, of course. And during that incarnation, we have our parents and all our older sisters and brothers, which in fact are the great educators. They awaken our thinking. What is happening then? It has to do with the fact that the educators of the child talk to it, surround the child with human attention and care. They surround it with, in fact, the vibrations, the frequencies of their thinking. And thus, this own thinking of the baby is starting to resonate, is starting to respond. Perhaps first by imitating the thoughts of other people, but later on forming its own thoughts. And it, you can compare it to a piano string which is vibrating when someone sings powerfully. Yeah? The powerful influence of the surroundings will realize that. And what were now our parents during that time? And that should be thinking beings, otherwise they could not awaken our thinking. They were thinking beings, said the theosophy, but they were perfected humans. They already reached the Buddhahood in a former life period of the planet. And now they had a task for the new humanity to awaken its real human consciousness, self-consciousness. We call them the Manasaputras, the sons of thought, Manasaputras. Putra is son, and Manasa, thoughts in Sanskrit. And what did they do? In fact, they incarnated in us. So there was a very great impact by their own thoughts, by their own consciousness, and they let our sleeping minds resonate. And that by their action, our mind was awakened relatively quickly, relatively. Otherwise, it would have taken us many million years, but it was now relatively a question of hundreds of thousands of years or something like that. So it was not in a day. It took many, many lives, but it was relatively quickly, and it was an act of compassion. Those higher beings knew the difficulties that they had passed during the former period. They knew that very well. They knew that the humanity would be greatly helped by giving as much as spiritual wisdom at the first moments, at the start, to take with you during that usually rather difficult journey through our human school. So it was an act of compassion. What did they do? They laid the foundations, they laid the foundations of all the great civilizations of real science, of real religion. They were the founders of the religious systems, the great philosophies of arts, of agriculture, everything which makes our human life higher than that of the animal. So they laid the foundations. It's our task to build on that foundations and try to develop it in our own best way. That is our task. So they are not, we also have our task. So it was really a big step. Before, I think, the pause, I wish to discuss one very interesting theosophical point. A point which when you think about it, it's very logic, but science, especially the present day biological science, has not the philosophical, awareness of that. But I'll say about this. According to theosophy, according to the old wisdom, it is only possible for more developed beings, higher beings, to become the educators, to become the beings that give the apt, the stimulating surroundings, the stimulating is how we call school ambience, the school for lower beings. Only more developed beings can do that. So lower beings cannot provide that stimulus for higher beings. It's always impossible. Think, for example, the very rare cases of a baby which is lost in the woods of India, and a female wolf finds it, and somehow it is adopted by the female wolf. It has happened in very rare cases. Now, then you see the female wolf gives it milk. It can awaken some animal-like capacities, like growling walking on force, etc. But it can never awaken our human possibilities. Yeah, the wolf mother is not able to do it. Yeah, it only starts when the baby comes back among human beings, among the society, and then those latent things are really growing again. So this is only one example, but you can look around and you will see it's always, there are many examples. For instance, a child is born in a normal family. The child has an enormous talent for music, enormous talent. But it is a normal family. Then you see that, of course, it will already have some stimulus because families, they sing or there is some music. But the very big awakening will come when the child meets someone which also have a great musical talent. And at that moment, there will be a recognition and a resonation. And then in the child, the urge is born from, I wish to develop these great musical things myself by meeting a man or a concert, going to a concert or whatever it is. Yeah. Sometimes it's the sounds of nature which awakens it. Very interesting, yeah. But there must be something which awakens it. Well, this practical wisdom means that we do not agree with the theory that human beings have their origin in an animal forefather, an animal ancestor, an animal ancestor. Yes, we think it's an impossibility. Yeah, and the animals instead, and that is a big story itself. The animals instead have their source in human beings, just the opposite way. Well, that's a big story. It has to do with very ancient phases of us in which we were able to lay the foundations for the animal life. We were doing that, but we were not conscious about that. Yeah, we didn't do it purposely, but it was the way nature worked. They came from us, and they are now trying, the animals, to reach our status. Yeah, the source which they try to come to the same possibilities as we humans. All animals try to do it. Well, these are basic thoughts. I can imagine that there may be some questions or something which you like to hear more about it. otherwise, yeah.
You said that the higher beings that helped awakening our thinking,
yeah,
that they were doing an act of compassion.
Yeah.
So does that mean that it wouldn't have been the normal order of things?
Yeah.
That they intervened?
Yeah. In fact, in all cases, it was their task to awaken our minds, but they started with the task earlier than strictly, karmically, they had to, yeah? So they tried to do it as early as possible. Yeah? At the first moment, then there was something, could be resonating in our, and it was not in all human individuals at the same time. One human being was more open to it, yeah? And the other less, but they tried to reach as much people as possible, especially to get very fundamental intuitions in us, because all human beings have a kind of deep intuition that the universe is, you may say, is governed by spiritual order. There is a kind of sound, spiritual, ethical basis of the universe. A kind of deep intuition that wrong is always wrong, right is always right, and that the ethics are something very fundamental. Well, that thought was really impressed in our minds during those four first periods, and you see it that it will have its impact during the whole journey of us. Because, of course, you see that many people are trying to follow paths which deviate from harmony, from unselfishness, but they know in a certain way, they have their conscience, there is an alarming, they have the, you can call it their own inner alarm system, for now what you are doing is not the best thing you can do. And that has to do with that enormous impact in that time. Yeah, there is a mirror in us.
So it was a successful intervention?
As far as they could. So it is not impossible that on another planet, which is not the Earth, but which has more spiritual development behind it, that there is a humanity which is more open at this moment, and things are going a little bit more harmoniously. That is not impossible, but in our situation, it was all the best they could handle. Yeah. They had to give their leading roles to more human beings. I mean, the demigods, the Manasaputras, were the leading entities, but they had to give that role, that function, to more human entities, the most highest developed humans, because the Earth was still materializing. So the most material point in our evolution was here, and in fact those beings would not be able to work then anymore. So it had to be taken over by more human beings. And it was done by the wise men of our humanity. They took it over. So it is a kind of really orderly, you see, talking about spiritual evolution, we talk about looking to the very, very, very far future. So we are giving people help for now, for this, but we are in fact, at the same time, we are not busy with only this day and the desires of this day. It has to do with a goal which takes us a long time. Other things which... they did it as early as possible. It had also consequences for those beings. At the moment they incarnated in us and they made us awake, from that moment on, they were, you can say, tied to all the things humanity did. So, that's why it's also an act of compassion. They were at that moment connected to us, and they had, and it had also consequences for their evolution. Yeah. Question?
The point of awareness, the higher, more aware beings who discovered their compassion to extend their ideas and thoughts to others. They must have that certain level of awareness of the highest point of the evolution, which is oneness with others.
Yeah.
Now,
true.
How would this spreading of the awareness, which would require some kind of governing of the others, how would that not work against the principle of oneness? If you feel one as the others, you don't see yourself in a position to govern others. How would that interact with, on one side, governing other spirits, on the other side, feeling one as them?
Yeah, I think the question is, of course, that's true. Those Manasaputras had already been Buddhas, so they knew the factual unity of all beings. They knew it very well. But they also knew the type of consciousness or the type of reality, which was reality for us then at that moment, as starting human beings. And that was, then what you say, that conscious idea of unity, that is something that you reach by enormous lot of experience. So it's just like being a parent and having a baby. Is we must start the education on the level of the baby. You can talk in a certain way. I must say this, of course, you try to be a good parent to little childs in all ways. Yet, when your thoughts are on that unity level, from the first beginning, the baby will feel it. But it is not a kind of education by words or by... because the baby, you must not talk to a baby about philosophical things, because it has no idea what you're talking about. But the fact that you live that idea of unity has already a kind of radiance, and in the baby, it will be felt, and it will also, as far as he has it in his own character, depending on former lives, as far as he has the possibility, he will also recognize it when he will be older. So in a certain way, they did what you say, they radiated the idea of unity, but in the same time, they had all the other simple actions, just like we in society now. We can radiate beautiful thoughts, but it can never be enough. We have our task here, our task there, from practical until theoretical, all thousand and one tasks, busy, busy, busy. And really spiritual is the person who always keeps in mind his ideals of that unity. That is enormous. The combining, having these ideas, combining it with standing in the material world, in the outer world, amidst all the, now you can say, weerstanden also, resistances, etc., which are not small. Yeah, we too are learning. It's very often, exactly when you are an idealistic person, you get even much more questions than the people who are not. You have so many questions about, but how can I do this? How can I do that? Yeah. So you have more questions than other people, and you try to solve them, and you try to... So it is a kind of how do you apply that one, only one unity of thought? And Ja, dit is de big uitdaging. Ja, Herman.
I think if you express also that you're coming from an unself-consciousness unity idea, coming more in the individual manifestation, and becoming more aware of ourselves,
stepping
away normally from the unity idea. So if the Manas Buddhas are coming there and start to help us, they create an atmosphere, of course, from unity, but on that moment we are not able to receive that very well. So by going through the development, and especially if we are sitting on the other side of the arc, we become more self-conscious of the unity. So that is the big difference, the unself-consciousness and the self-consciousness fact. Yeah? And that is what you see in life as well. If people develop well, as a child they are very much on themselves and they have their friends. If they grow really in a spiritual level, they will act more from the oneness.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we can see that not all human beings are developed already in that direction, but that is the goal we have to go.
Yeah.
And I think that is for me one a very important aspect to realize that the moment we go from unself-consciousness to self-consciousness,
that is
self with a capital S then,
I will also talk about it after the pause, because it is kind of critical period there, because our self-conscious, our ego-consciousness was in that period very often used to focus on yourself and your own interests. So that look to it as a kind of very primitive first phase of self-consciousness. To think that you are separate, and then you discover that each time again, it is a false presumption. But it takes a growing of self-consciousness, and if the average person, it's not about you as individuals, but you as individuals may be here or here or here, as the average humanity is only just started to develop that self-consciousness, that is the thing which the human school means. Okay, I think after the pause we have a few things about this period, and we will talk about computers, machine learning, robots, and perhaps the design baby. Yeah. I propose to start again, and it is this is our you can say three growth phases, and which H.P. Blavatsky called for practical reasons the Lemurian phase and the Atlantic phase of our spiritual history and the present phase, and it is also, you can in fact very well pinpoint what kind of consciousness aspects we were developing then. And in the Lemurian phase, our first period of thinking, it was more the vital aspects within our desire thinking, within our desire aspect. So vitality and desires were very important then. You may say it was still only starting to think, because vitality and desires are animal-like aspects. But that's the point where we started. The Atlantic phase was the desire aspect of desire thinking, so very focused on desires and trying to reach goals. And the present phase is which you see around you when you simply investigate, that it intellect has a great value and it is greatly developed, and desire thinking is still dominant. So the intellect is usually used for trying to get this or to reach that or to achieve a kind of goal. So intellect is still not dominant. Dominant is still the desire of thinking, and the intellect is usually used to it, which does not say how you do it, because you as individuals can have another, how do you call it, another character build it up. That first phase, there was humanity, we normally were at that moment kind of little toddlers when you compare it with the present incarnation. And we instinctively followed leaders, spiritual leaders, who recognized it. But we were also very open to all kind of impulses. So we had self-consciousness, we had the inclination, okay, to listen to those leaders, but there was also the outer world, and we, in our eyes, the outer world was highly interesting in all its external effects and things, just like a child. So it was both. We were open to all kinds of impulses. But yet, at that moment, the possibility was there that gods and god kings walked among men, because they were accepted, they were recognized, they could function. Yeah? And the gods were the Manasaputras, the god kings that were the later human beings, which had, were the leaders. And there's a very old tradition, for instance, with the Egyptian mythology, that before the pharaohs, there were the kind of god pharaohs. Yeah, godlike human beings, and that is from that time. Then comes the Atlantic phase, the most material phase of the whole earth. Yeah, all beings were in their most substantial material phase. And at that moment, there was generally an inclination to identify with the physical body, with the purely external world. Yet it was always a question of free will. So there were always, during that time, human beings who choose to remember the lessons of the Manasaputras, keep the fire of spiritual consciousness alive in them, also during civilizations which were highly material, then they tried to keep it alive too, yeah? And free will, but generally people thought that material goals were almost the whole reality, and that their whole fulfillment lied in material goals. Now you come here to the point, there is the hierarchy of compassion. That means all you can call those people, those human beings, which were conscious of the purpose of life, they always tried to help humanity wherever possible. And we call it the hierarchy of compassion. That's the wise men, the initiators, the great reformers of the world. But those people had to retract themselves, their education, to inner circles, to only to those people who were ready to take it in, to understand it, and who were ready because they would not misuse the knowledge. Because all knowledge can easily be misused, which would be an enormous damage to other human beings. So, to prevent it, the esoteric schools, the wisdom schools, were closed. And it means closed not in the sense that you cannot enter, but in the sense that you had first to prove that you were ready, and then they were open. The point is the proof. For everyone, doesn't matter what race, what color. So that was the only way to really have enormous impact on the societies yet. Via their own chelas, via their own pupils, they could also have a very stimulating, spiritualizing impact also in very material civilizations, yeah? In that indirect way. The present phase, that is the phase where we are starting the line upwards. There is an awakening understanding, but in the same time you see all around you an enormous force of what you may call the Atlantic habits. So there is an habit built up in the former millions of years, and you see it still in much focus, much attention and care to the physical body, for instance, to sports. Also still many, many people thinking that the external power, external possessions are very precious, yeah? You see it all around you, yeah? In fact, all Atlantic inheritance. And this is a kind of, starting of the choice. And there is, you may really call it a kind of struggle. And in fact, you see that struggle each day in the world. And it is, our contribution to give some weight on one part of the scale or on the other part of the scale. Yeah? Theosophy can be partly spread now openly in their general outlines. The general thoughts can be spread openly to the world, and H.P. Blavatsky did it. Old thoughts, universal thoughts, which also will, you can call, which we now try to spread as far as possible, because we know that many people. And unless we are not with an enormous gray group, but we know in fact that many people are searching for truth. There are many people who are ready for those things. And now we hope to reach them. Yeah. Then comes the prospects which are sketched. Unpacking our inner divinity. And why is our world so full of suffering? Yeah, that it has to do with, you can call a little bit, that we really, most people really need time and time and many experiences to learn, to really change the character. Of course, theoretically, you can say, okay, this is not, I learned something, but really to apply it in your lives, to change your way of thinking, you change your way of acting, that takes time. And it should take time, because when you try to make a kind of revolution in yourself, it is seldom has the results. Usually you only create chaos. Yeah, so we always say people think well, act well, thought about it, and do not change things on one moment. And that's the way you can really change. Deeper meaning is in fact that we now are learning and learning and learning to taking a more active part in the hierarchy of compassion by developing our spiritual potencies. We can really consciously help the wise people to help the whole humanity. Yeah. There it comes. Is our future high tech? And I have some questions and we can discuss. Technology is simply using devices to control nature or to influence the natural forces. And it has an enormous, attention in our world. Yeah? It has to do with economic interests. It has to do with military interests. And there is also, you can call it a great attractiveness, because many people are attracted to the newest device or the wonderful possibilities of technology. They really like to read about it, to see it, etc. And so it has a kind of attraction of itself. And we must say that by that fact, you can at this moment, at the moment where we now are in our evolution, you can almost say that when we are able to do something by technology, we will do it. So for us, the whole idea of experimenting and trying out, even when we really do not understand the consequences and do not foresee the consequences, when something is possible technically, the inclination is, well, then we start. So it is kwetsbaar. How do you call it?
Vulnerable.
Vulnerable, in fact. Eh? You can say something which should be led in good channels. We have no problems about technology in itself. In each phase of our development, we will use technology adapted to the thoughts and the insights that we have. So technology will always be a part of our civilization. It will grow with us, but in all cases, it should be the servant of us. Yeah. So we have no problems in the fact that there is a kind of technology. It's more, okay, which and when? Also very interesting, when you look from the standpoint of consciousness, what is a computer? A computer is a device, and a device, a clock, a laptop, etc., is in fact a constellation of mineral and elemental elements. In fact, it is a cooperation of primitive beings. Yeah. So that were the elemental and mineral beings, that were the beings in the lowest schools of our cosmic life. And what does that mean? They do not think yet. They have not developed their own will in a strong way as we. That means that they follow all the commands that we give them. And happily, they usually do it. Otherwise, we could not make a device and use it. Yeah? They follow our commands as men. So it's also with the computer. And when you look at it from the consciousness side, and you know what kind of entities make up the computer, then you can ask, okay, a computer is also such a device. Why is a computer momentarily so much used? It can calculate, it means it can information, it can, how do you call it, manage information in an enormously quick way. Yeah? We cannot understand how many calculations in 1 second are used by a computer. So it is that rapidity that makes it very interesting for us, because then we can make a GPS system to know where we are. We can search on internet thousands of articles in 1 second, etc., etc. So that is the strong point of the computer. And then you have now the question, openly discussed, will computers ever be able to think? And from our standpoint, a computer is programmed by human beings. It is consisted of beings who are not at all ready to think, because that takes enormous evolution before they are ready to think. Then we say a computer will never be able to think. And then immediately we hear, okay, but how do you verklaren, explain machine learning? Because at this moment they use it in a kind of smart way that they program the computer to program itself. It is possible, of course. Yeah, you have a kind of a big layer. Okay, there's a fundamental layer of programming, and within that layer you have several parts of the computer who are able to react and to program itself. That means always that the computer is finding for itself correlations, associations between the data that he gets. He must have enormous lot of data. Within those data, he is finding correlations which we perhaps did not see, finding things which come together or act together. And he can do that very quickly. Now, when you have a lot of capacity, you can have a machine learning machine which in one afternoon is becoming better than the best Go player of the world, because they did it. The champion, the world champion of that Japanese play, the Go, and they really only needed one day to make the computer so, how do you call it, get those associations to win, to become better than the best human Go player of the world. So machine learning has possibilities, but you will always see within a very special, how do you call it,
area
where the whole, how do you call it, the whole problem is well defined, very strictly defined, and very strictly defined rules, and then the computer can beat you. Chess, Go, in fact, very simple systems when you compare it to the world. But yet, some people think, well, in the future we get learning, we get thinking computers. And then we always ask, what in the computer is then starting to think? Is that this atom or this atom? Which atom is starting to think? Now, they have no answer to that. And we think it will not happen. Yeah.
So, if I understand you well, the computer is very good in pattern recognizing.
Yeah.
Within limited systems, Go is a limited play, chess is limited, although the number of moves are very large, but it is still limited.
Exactly, that's exactly the point.
And then it is good, but it is closed system, but when there is open system, then it has to think, and that is not able to think.
Yeah, that means so that he still, when you give it an open system, for instance, you give it many data from the society, and he should find their correlations. They already did it. And then, and if you then ask to such a computer, this is only one example. Okay, give me a photo of an CEO. So, how do you call it? The big boss of a firm. And now, what do you think, what kind of photo he will present you? A white man of about 50 years. Yeah?
But it's still limited, the data is...
They have put a lot of, enormous lot of data about the society in them. Perhaps he just walking through internet with all the data that you can find there. And then he has the correlation, you want a photo of a CEO? Well, that's a white man of 50 years, because that's the thing which I encounter, yeah? And, of course, the computer has no idea about the social prejudices and all the things which has happened in the past where you have, which has led to the situation that is you're normally white people for 50 years. Yeah, Herman?
I think you have to make a step in between.
Yeah.
There are two things, that is knowledge databases.
Yeah.
So you collect information and you start to use that information. And you have machine learning. And machine learning, that means that the computer is able to reprogram himself. So that he learns how to use better that information he was collecting. And in your example of a ghost system, so what you do first is collecting information, you put it in your knowledge database, and then you can try to upgrade your algorithm, how to use that knowledge, what is in your database. And the last step is what is called machine learning. So the machine learns to reprogram itself in a better way. But of course, all the opportunities in that machine are in fact programmed or built in hardware by human beings. Maybe very clever ones, but in itself, that is a limitation, of course.
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah.
The answer to definitive question of where science lies in terms of spiritual development.
Yeah.
There's been always, you know, 400 years ago, the position of the sun in the solar system, based on what they knew, the sun was center of the universe. 30 years ago, if you ask computer scientists, could we ever win, can a computer ever win from a human being, you would say, no, it's just a human being. Would it make sense to sort of step down from a definitive answer and have a caveat and say, well, based on what we know now, computers can never think? Or are we stuck to saying, oh, I have a definitive answer now, regardless of what happens in future, computers can never think.
Well, what I very often remark is that the people who talk about thinking computers, when you ask what is your definition of thinking, then they are a little bit fake. And in theosophy, it is a very strict definition. So we talk about thinking, and for us, it is a mental process of really observing, seeing mental things, which are called thoughts, ethereal things. And when we exchange thoughts, we are in fact very busy radiating with mental things, and you are radiating back, and this is human life, in fact. In fact, our human consciousness is more on the mental ethereal level than on the physical level, because we are, each second, are we busy with that ethereal activities. Well, that is very strict. And but such a scientist talking about thinking, it is so vague that when a computer imitates thinking, so it seems as if he thinks, he says, yeah, he's thinking. And then we say, no, 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 it is the programmer, he has made it possible that he can imitate it to a large extent, so that from the outside, it has the impression of a human being which makes a decision and which is thinking. And then we say, look to the inside. No. Entirely something different. So in our impression is that when you have a task in a society where you need real insight or creative intelligence or a sense of ethics, and in fact for many tasks you need those three, then a computer can only be a help, a kind of a tool, but nothing more than that, because he can have never a sense of ethics. You can program, okay, when I'm a robot and I encounter a man on the street and I have a self-driving car, I stop. But it is not ethics what he is doing. You programmed the self-driving car, or you can even program it very fine that he does things which are ethically accepted, but for the car itself, there is no ethical question at all. I'm not sure whether I'm clear, but
you're explaining what we know currently. What computers can do. I'm talking about the unknown knowns.
Yeah.
I'm talking about what we don't know to make a definitive judgment.
I think you have the good houding, attitude, to remember that always. And we always also advise that to people studying theosophy, exactly the same. Keep that openness. And in the same time, you can say, at this moment, I come to that conclusion.
That's what.
Yeah, very well, exactly. Yeah, I can say a little bit more about what theosophy said. For instance, in the Atlantic phase, so we ourselves were a few millions ago in that Atlantic phase. In some aspects, we were technically more advanced than now, more. But it was another kind of technology. And one of the things that we could do then is we did not make use exactly, perhaps, I don't know whether they were laptops, I don't know. But one of the things that they had, that was a kind of flying machines. And those flying machines were somehow, you must not think about pure molecular atomic things, but they were somehow ensouled by primitive beings. So they had, and it is on the astral level, that's not the spiritual level, Lord, but on an astral level, they could use astral beings to ensoul such a thing. And so that is, in fact, something which you, when you would tell it now to a scientist, he would say it is impossible. But those things are impossible.
But another thing what you can take in consideration is that, of course, if human being will develop much more, we can develop much more clever computers.
Yeah.
That's a thing in itself. But the question, what I think you understand from this, is that can a computer reinvent himself?
Yeah.
And there is always a limitation in it, because what is his capability in terms of pre-programming?
Yeah.
So we will always build computers and we'll make clever use of it. And if we are more clever, we will much clever one. If you look at the computers nowadays, compared with the first one in 1947 and so on, it's an amazing improvement.
Yeah.
So, but that is a big difference. Will the computer be able to invent himself?
Yeah.
And I think that answer is no.
Yeah. It's always we lay the foundations. Yeah.
The computer nowadays consists of minerals and elementals, you said. But if the elementals itself will evolve to the level of thinking, we're talking about human beings.
Yeah.
So, will a computer ever think?
You have to have some patience.
But of them have evolved to the human level, then, but then you are talking about humans.
Yeah.
And are we computers? You could put the question otherwise. Are we thinking computers? Are we computers as we are sitting here now?
Now, yeah, it is what you say. When you are very consequent, and you are consequent, it is not impossible that very, 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 very in the past, somewhere very, very, there was a time that we were a molecular entity, part of a laptop. We ourselves, true. Yeah. But we talk about a large evolution scale. Yeah.
Yeah, but it has nothing to do with computers will start thinking.
No, it has nothing to do with
conscious being.
The whole process of thinking is much more what a computer is doing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Of course, many computers can do clever jobs much better than a lot of people.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it doesn't mean that he has the creativity of thinking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Besides then the whole evolution process where we take part of.
I think that's an important point. I have three, how you call it, a kind of touchstones, a kind of three thoughts with which you can use to ascertain whether a new technique is for the welfare of humanity or not. If a kind of application will help humanity in its spiritual evolution, yes or no? And these are only three possibilities, suggestions, which can be improved probably a lot. Yeah, it is only to give a first inkling of idea of when we really control the technology, the technical developments. And the first thing is then we, and you will see, we go from the physical to the psychological to the mental part of ourselves. We start with the physical, leads a kind of application to viewing our body as ourselves, or leads it to our awareness that our body is an instrument of our consciousness, of our real, what we are really in ourselves. And I mention this because at this moment there is a quick development in medicine that you, by sensors, you can, how do you call it, scan all kinds of things which happen in your body. Yeah, blood pressure and also all kinds of substances in your blood. And it will be, you will be able, if you like, to see what is happening during each minute. Yeah, and I can say you, there happens a lot in your body during each minute. And it's changing always, yeah, from here to there. And so it may be interesting for someone who has a kind of illness, yeah, diabetes perhaps, yeah, to know some things. He can use it as a tool. But you can also see that when our people are really thinking that they are the body and they should take care of all those aspects, then they can be immersed in the technology, and all their energy and interest, etc., will be focused on hey, what happens now to my body? What happens now? This is only one example, but you see that the applications may be in such a way that it really hinders our spiritual evolution. It's the same, for instance, at this moment there are possibilities to have brain-computer connections, and there are some interesting applications for people who have miss an arm or something like that. Yeah, very interesting. And I think that can broaden their lives. Yeah, that has also... It does not mean that when you have not such a robot arm that you are not able to live as a real human being, because you are without an arm. It doesn't depend on your body, but it may be useful, yeah? Practical. Does it lead to a growing psychological dependence? Now, happily, we have the discussions now that things like Facebook and all kinds of other apps, etc., and software, they have a built-in psychological tricks that people tend to go back to Facebook and back and back and back. Yeah, in all kinds of ways, they try to keep you to the next app and the next message and the next thing, etc. They know a lot of psychology and they use it for that purpose. And that gives a psychological dependence. And well, that is, happily it is discussed about it, because it is very clear that those firms are not busy with the well-being of their clients. They are busy making money, very easy, yeah. Because then there is more advertisement and you can sell all the data of all the things that you do on Facebook. And so here is, I think, an example of a real thing which is really a hindrance. And in the same time, can you use those systems also for psychological self-control? Yeah, I think, of course. Yeah, simplest idea is that on internet, if you look well, there is here and there information about who you can stand above all those psychological attractions. Yeah? This on the internet itself, you can find wise information about not to be enslaved by internet. Yeah. But it is rare, because then you need some real knowledge of our human consciousness. Yeah. Which we also try to promote, because that knowledge was given by H.P. Blavatsky. And in our courses, Thinking Differently, we do a lot with that.
There's another factor.
Yeah.
That nowadays people don't want to pay for that.
Yeah.
So if people should want to pay for the thing, then you don't need the psychological tricks, because the firm can exist without using advertisement. So when people say, I want to pay for Facebook, I want to pay for Google, and so on, then you can leave out the tricks used nowadays. So there's also part for our
customers. Yeah, very good. The responsibility of the clients itself.
Until we want to pay for it, we will be tricked.
Clear idea. And the second, the mental way, is also something. We all know that when you think about using internet, using chat rooms, etc., that you can narrow yourself by just having communication with people which are completely agreeing with you, to say it very simply, so that you encounter information which you already know, or which you like to hear, which you like to see, and now that kind of bubble systems are now active, and when you are aware of it, you can of course prevent that happening. Yeah, but then you should be aware of it, that that danger is always there. And also the algorithms of the search machines, what is at the first things that you see in the list, it is all those things which you have researched before. So things which you're already interested in, and then you get that first. And so when you want really something very original, you must look in another way. Well, I think this is also a very, very important thing. And how much more discussion about it, the better. That people are aware. And all three are part of, in fact, what we call independent thinking. As human beings, we have now the responsibility for what we think and do. We are self-conscious. We make our own path. And the consequences of all the things we do are also, according to theosophy, by cause and effect, we will encounter later in this life or in the lives which are lying before us. So each human being is factually responsible for the things he does and thinks. And that factual responsibility means that we have the urgent need to lead our lives and not be led by other people. Yeah, we must have our own decisions. And all three are needed, physically, psychologically, mentally, that we can become really independent thinkers. People who, what Plato said, who tried to think unveiled, without prejudices, without the limitations of the thoughts that are now in our society. Yeah? You try to be really an investigator of truth as much as you can. Very important in this world of net news, of
fake news.
Yeah, fake news. Is the ideal society high tech? What do you think? I hope to get the answer.
There are two possibilities.
Yeah.
What it should be or what it will be.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. If you have to put money down, then you tend to talk about what it will be.
Yeah.
But if you have to talk about the ideas, yeah, you tend to talk about what it should be.
What it should be.
So,
yeah,
what's the question? Is the ideal
society? I think the, what should
what
be.
What should the ideal society, what, yeah, what it will be? Because reality is that there is no getting away from high tech. That's the way. How could we run courthouses in 100 years without high tech?
Yeah.
How could we run hospitals, things that we can't even possibly imagine now?
Yeah.
Could be one hospital without that.
Yeah.
I take in 100 years. So it, there is no way that ideal society will be without IT.
Exactly. That's a big point.
Should it be? That's a difference.
Yeah. Yeah. But even when you look about how it should be, you can still imagine that they use technology. But because they have always, I'll call it, the wisdom, that gives us the possibilities to, in fact, use it with much more effect than we now do, because we are completely not putting energy in 101 external goals, which presently are so much, advocated. And you can be very focused on the real important things of life. And that means that also the computers, which will help us at that point, will in a certain way be more effective. And we can do there more. Yeah, for instance, simply, we had in former days, we had Stonehenge, etc., the kind of cosmical observation places to look at what, and what moments the sun rises during summer solstice and spring solstice, etc. And with our technology, we can perhaps do it more precisely, yeah, when we have the real knowledge. And those cosmic connections are very important. We will one day recognize it. Only one example.
But yeah? I think on a certain moment, if we are developed much more in our spiritual capabilities, we don't need computers anymore.
Uh-huh.
We don't need that particular hardware anymore.
Yeah.
Because then we are start to be conscious on an older level.
Yeah.
We can do communication with each other on an older bit in an older way, so we don't need smartphones anymore, etc., etc.
Yeah. Oh, that means that in a certain way, I know that in the theosophical literature you find all kind of indications of that possibilities, because there are already now people who have developed those spiritual faculties. And so when you when you read about the teachers of H.P. Blavatsky, which are called masters of life, they have, by their complete spiritual unselfish lives, they have, for instance, the ability to emanate or to focus their consciousness in their deepest core of their being, and from that core, from that eternal core, they can uitstralen, radiate it,
project it,
that's the good word, to any place they like. And they can be there consciously, knowing exactly what is happening there. Yeah. Now, that means that a lot of discussions about aeroplanes and pollution, etc., is in fact no point anymore.
The spiritual Skype.
Yeah. That means also that you can be a pupil of a teacher, and it is not needed that the teacher is living near you. Yeah, it's not needed. Now, this is also a very important thing. Yeah, I think I take the closing, and then we can also go on. Just as kind of closing thoughts from the awakening of our thinking makes us human beings conscious co-workers of the planet Earth. It makes us responsible, and from that moment on, the incessant inner struggle between our conscience and our personal egocentrical inclination started. It also gives our life a fundamental dignity. By our experiences as human beings, we learn to discover what true friendship is, what true brotherhood is, true wisdom and true beauty and true love. We learn to discover the things that make life meaningful and joyful, that give us hope and vision and courage. And we have outgrown the period in which we took everything as it comes, as all animals still do. So we will never return to that point. Yeah. And core ideas, theosophical, our universal unselfish ideals, are a reflection of universal facts, basically of the unity of all life. There is a direct path to wisdom because we all have all wisdom in us, latent, slumbering, and we can manage to awaken it. Very important thing, we say it is not needed to suffer to learn. We have the possibility to foretell things, to understand things beforehand. We have the possibility to learn a lot of human beings who are a step further than we are, so that we are warned and there is no need to step in the same problems. And we all have that possibility. So it is not true that suffering is needed. Yeah? Of course, there is also some suffering, but it is when people say from we learn by suffering, no. It is not needed. We have a direct path to wisdom. You can also say you can be a very good captain on a ship, and there is no need that you once have experienced a shipwreck. It's not necessary. And we can help each other greatly in this path of inner development. Okay. Questions? Otherwise, you will close. Yeah. And the closing is by the Gayatri of the Rig Veda, which in fact is a universal thought about the inner path, which is an inner path because, in fact, we become more and more one with our deepest core. And that is the golden sun. Oh, thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds, so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity, which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection, stimulated by thine own radiant light.